queste startup, però già sanno che un giorno vogliono rivendere la partecipazione o l'azione, perché il loro interesse è sfruttare il surplus che la startup ha generato. Ultime fonti di finanziamento di cui vorrei citare sono i business angel. I business angel sono i titolari di impresa, manager in attività e in pensione che possiedono risorse finanziarie e con capacità e conoscenze che possono immettere all'interno dell'impresa. Naturalmente esistono due tipi di business angel: i finanziari, che contribuiscono solo al capitale di rischio, e gli industriali, che sono soci in quanto apportano capitale di rischio, ma allo stesso tempo partecipano all'attività di impresa. Per quanto riguarda il marketing delle startup, non posso fare a meno che parlare del growth hacking. Il growth hacker è qualcuno che sta facendo di tutto il possibile per attirare nuovi clienti al suo prodotto. Naturalmente, le imprese che adottano questo tipo di marketing migliorano i propri prodotti in base alle informazioni di feedback che ricevono dai clienti. Naturalmente, gli strumenti più usati in questa tipologia di marketing sono i consigli dei clienti, perché un cliente soddisfatto è la miglior forma di pubblicità gratuita. Poi abbiamo la pubblicità, che è una leva fondamentale, e l'utilizzo dei lavoratori part-time che permettono l'invio di mail, la cura di pagine online e operazioni di call center. Infine la SEO, cioè l'ottimizzazione per i motori di ricerca. Per quanto riguarda la distribuzione, ora entriamo nel microcosmo del marketing operativo. Parliamo di distribuzione come leva del marketing mix perché esistono tre modelli, possiamo dire anche due, perché il modello delle 4P è poco utilizzato perché il prodotto qui viene apprezzato solo per le soprattutto per le caratteristiche materiali. Invece, con l'evoluzione, quindi col modello delle 7P, vengono aggiunte tre leve fondamentali che rappresentano l'immaterialità del prodotto o del servizio, che sono le persone che contribuiscono affinché il progetto si completi, le evidenze fisiche che sono a supporto del prodotto, come il packaging. Vedi per esempio Zara, in cui il packaging ha più valore dello stesso vestito, e i processi del servizio che completano l'offerta. L'ultimo modello di cui voglio parlare è il modello delle 4C. Qui il consumatore assume un ruolo fondamentale, l'offerta è studiata e proposta in termini di soddisfazione, il prezzo è interpretato come il sacrificio che il consumatore è disposto a sostenere per il beneficio. In questo modello la distribuzione diventa convenience, cioè il consumatore nell'entrare a contatto con l'offerta deve trovare convenienza. Per quanto riguarda il settore della distribuzione in Italia, io, come ha detto il mio professore, vi parlerò soprattutto della grande distribuzione. Della grande distribuzione perché il mio caso pratico verte è un supermercato online. La grande distribuzione, come ben sappiamo, è una forma di vendita al dettaglio di prodotti di largo consumo, così come tutte le altre imprese. In questo periodo di pandemia da SARS-CoV-19 ha avuto sia dei risentimenti e che cambiamenti di abitudine. Infatti, come si evince dall'indagine Censit, il tasso medio annuo di crescita di PIL si è progressivamente ridotto. Naturalmente voglio riflettere su questi due punti, perché la distribuzione alimentare e non alimentare è un settore di traino per la nostra economia e rappresenta uno dei maggiori comparti occupazionali per il Sud Italia. Basta pensare che il 60% degli occupati al settore della distribuzione del Sud Italia è donna. Prima di parlare del mio caso pratico, voglio dire che l'e-commerce oggigiorno si è sviluppato moltissimo e ha registrato una crescita esponenziale che ha sottratto delle quote importanti anche al mercato, alla distribuzione moderna, quindi al mercato reale. Questo è un progetto che è già partito da molto tempo, però in questo periodo di pandemia ha aumentato. E concludo dicendo che il paniere di consumo ora è cambiato, perché prima era formato soprattutto dalla classe giovane che acquistavano per esempio su Zalando e così via. Ora invece la propensione alla spesa online aumenta e il paniere di consumo aumenta anche con quelle classi che prima non avevano quasi mai acquistato online. Ora vi parlerò del mio caso pratico Campania Più. Campania Più è una società SRLS che ha due soci, in cui siamo io e mio fratello, e siamo situati a Nocera Superiore in provincia di Salerno. Campania Più, come già detto, è un supermercato online nato all'inizio di marzo che effettua consegne a domicilio. Abbiamo realizzato la nostra idea in un periodo di pandemia proprio perché le vendite online sono aumentate esponenzialmente e il nuovo modello di shopping ha creato nuovi bisogni da soddisfare. Lo staff è formato da noi soci e da un operatore che ha il compito di stampare gli ordini, preparare le ricevute, svolgere operazioni di call center e mailing list. Naturalmente, come si evince dalle categorie qui che sto presentando, i nostri prodotti sono 5-600, non sono moltissimi, ma ricoprono bene o male tutti i generi presenti all'interno di una casa, dal genere bevande, alimentari, igiene personale, fino ad arrivare anche ai prodotti per gli animali, che ormai quasi tutti posseggono all'interno di una casa. Il supermercato è molto facile, il nostro sito internet è molto facile e veloce da utilizzare. Infatti, i nostri clienti navigano tra le diverse categorie di prodotto e mettono nel carrello solo quelli che desiderano acquistare. Naturalmente, l'ordine può essere anche fatto chiamando al nostro operatore o tramite WhatsApp. Per quanto riguarda, diciamo, i nostri principi ispiratori e i punti di forza, noi ci riteniamo più convenienti. Più convenienti perché? Perché sul nostro sito troviamo solo offerte, di prodotti con prezzi imbattibili. Nel senso, noi all'interno del nostro sito mettiamo solo prodotti che rispetto alla concorrenza, quindi al supermercato reale, siamo competitivi, nel senso che il prezzo, se non è uguale, può essere anche inferiore rispetto alla concorrenza. Questo perché? Perché i nostri fornitori sono i cash and carry, i due maggiori cash and carry della provincia di Salerno, mentre i nostri clienti sono sia le famiglie, come anche bar, ristoranti e qualsiasi persona che vorrebbe acquistare. Il secondo principio ispiratore è più comodo, nel senso che noi effettuiamo una consegna gratuita nell'agro rocerino sarnese, cioè nelle zone limitrofe
Scusa,
del nostro.
Ivan, scusa, chiarisci meglio il primo punto, che voi prendete le offerte da cash and carry, giusto?
No, le offerte che noi abbiamo sia prodotti fissi che sono prodotti di tutti i generi, però il nostro punto di forza, come si evince dalla presentazione, sono le super offerte. Ora, quando vi parlo delle super offerte, cioè le super offerte sono ogni 7-10 giorni i cash, così come la grande distribuzione, fanno un volantino. Questo volantino anche in formato PDF. Noi andiamo a prendere questo volantino con, diciamo, 70-80 offerte, più o meno mettono alla settimana. Prendiamo queste, diciamo, offerte, le analizziamo, vediamo durante il periodo quali sono le più convenienti e le più usate. Per esempio, come nel periodo di Pasqua hanno messo le offerte con Giovetti Kinder. Noi, naturalmente, nel periodo di Pasqua si vendono molto e quindi sul nostro sito abbiamo aggiunto nella sezione super offerte appunto Giovetti Kinder. Solo questo è il discorso delle offerte, però diciamo sul sito sono presenti prodotti a prezzi fissi. Il secondo punto, principio ispiratore è il più comodo, nel senso che noi effettuiamo una consegna gratuita in 24 ore a domicilio con una spesa minima di 30 euro, solo però nelle zone limitrofe la nostra sede operativa, quindi nell'agro nocerino sarnese. Più sicuro invece perché, a differenza degli altri siti, sul nostro sito paghi direttamente alla consegna, quindi non devi, immettere all'interno del sito nessun tipo, di, numero di carta di credito, CCV e così via. Per quanto riguarda i nostri punti di forza, invece, ho parlato già delle super offerte, vorrei parlare, della seconda caratteristica che ci contraddistingue, cioè l'assenza di un negozio fisico. Noi non possediamo un negozio fisico e la nostra filosofia è appunto zero scorte. Zero scorte perché ogni giorno io o mio fratello, che siamo i due soci, andiamo a comprare la merce che ci è stata ordinata. Noi compriamo solo la merce che ci è stata ordinata. Questo ci permette un vantaggio, rispetto vantaggio di costi, perché noi non dobbiamo comprare i beni che abbiamo sul nostro sito, ma le andiamo a prendere man mano. E diciamo, il secondo vantaggio che ci offre questa filosofia è che il secondo vantaggio che ci offre la filosofia zero scorte è che noi non abbiamo i costi per la conservazione fisica dei beni. Per quanto riguarda invece, ora parlo della strategia di marketing che abbiamo adottato e diciamo per campagna più l'asset fondamentale è la pubblicità. Infatti abbiamo iniziato col volantinaggio, con il passaparola, con sponsorizzazione tramite le nostre pagine social personali, per poi, diciamo, dopo un mesetto e mezzo siamo passati al coupon sconto. per agevolare le persone a farci conoscere dai parenti e dagli amici, fino ad arrivare alle influencer. Le influencer, però, voglio ricordare che queste sponsorizzazioni che noi facciamo tramite gli influencer sono assolutamente gratuite. Il costo che abbiamo sono solo il costo della compra dei prodotti. Per quanto riguarda invece, ho messo qui la strategia di growth hacking, perché noi naturalmente accettiamo i consigli dei clienti, perché il cliente, quando fa l'ordine, deve mettere anche il suo numero di telefono. Il numero di telefono è importante per due motivi per noi: il primo è per avvisare il cliente della consegna, e il secondo per avvisarlo delle super offerte che cambiano di settimana in settimana. Naturalmente noi facciamo una pubblicità multicanale e abbiamo, penso, un buon posizionamento sui motori di ricerca. Naturalmente voglio concludere dicendo che ad oggi i nostri consumatori, come abbiamo detto, sono quelli nelle zone limitrofe della nostra area, però il nostro obiettivo è portare i nostri principi ispiratori e i prodotti della nostra regione sulla terra di tutta Italia. Questo lo stiamo facendo, come ho detto, tramite le influencer che ci stanno dando visibilità anche in quelle zone in cui, diciamo, non riusciamo ad arrivare. L'ultima cosa che voglio ricordare sono i costi che questa startup ha. I costi che questa startup ha sono due, perché, come abbiamo detto, la filosofia zero scorte ci permette di ridurli, e questi sono due, cioè 400 euro che ci permettono la sponsorizzazione tramite Facebook ed Instagram, e 300 euro che sono il costo dell'operatore che svolge operazioni di call center, mailing list e prepara gli ordini con le ricevute. Naturalmente voglio concludere dicendo che il ricarico su ogni prodotto è del 20-25%, e per coprire questi costi, quindi questi costi fissi che sono 700-800 euro al mese, l'azienda deve deve ricevere ordini per un minimo di 100 euro giornalieri. Grazie per l'attenzione.
Grazie mille Ivan, e complimenti per questa attività imprenditoriale. Mi faccio giusto una domanda, un paio di domande in realtà. Allora, la prima è collegata a come renderete il vostro modello di business scalabile, e la seconda è più collegata invece alla tipologia di prodotti che vendete, e a come scegliete i prodotti sul territorio. Cioè, perché lei ha parlato, no, del fatto che tra i fornitori ci sono anche altri distributori, però ha enfatizzato anche il legame con il territorio locale. Quindi volevo giusto qualche informazione aggiuntiva su quali sono quei produttori locali che scegliete, e se avete dei criteri sulla base dei quali li scegliete.
Allora, i prodotti che scegliamo, sono dei prodotti fissi che noi nella zona di Nocera siamo a 10 minuti dalla costiera amalfitana, quindi abbiamo il limoncello della costiera, abbiamo le alici di Cetara, il tonno, prodotti campani dell'agro noceno sarnese, è presente il pomodoro San Marzano, il pienolo del Vesuvio, il datterino giallo. Diciamo, io sono un produttore di pomodori, fondamentalmente. Questo, è un'attività che ora ho iniziato a sviluppare per diversificare, più che altro. I prodotti della nostra regione, proprio perché vorrei portare questi prodotti sulla tavola di tutti gli italiani. Come ho iniziato con le influencer tipo Antonella Fordalisi, Andrea Melagodo, Lucia e i suoi pasticci, sono delle influencer della zona, quindi che possono sponsorizzare i nostri prodotti tipici nelle regioni, dove con la nostra sponsorizzazione, rispondendo alla prima domanda, noi vogliamo diventare scalabili proprio attraverso queste sponsorizzazioni di Facebook e Instagram, che ci permettono una tot di visibilità, a seconda di quanto si paga naturalmente, per arrivare, per espanderci, per espandere il nostro mercato, la nostra cerchia di clienti.
Grazie mille, Ivan.
A lei.
Altre domande? Questo sì. Allora è sufficiente, la ringrazio da Kunzi.
Grazie a lei.
Si presenti Marta Antichi. We switch off in English, if I remember. Antichi discuss a thesis, green and digital strategies in the fashion business, evidence in the sportswear industry. So now the topic, we move to green and digital strategies and the industry is fashion. Marta, please read the declaration.
The undersigned Marta Antichi, matricola number 087469, enrolled in the Corso di Laurea Magistrale in International Accounting and Management, considering the decree number 461-2020, protocol number 52533 of the Rector of the University of Siena, dated March 11, 2020, which authorizes the online procedure for the final exam, graduation and public proclamation, being aware that according to Article 76 of the DPR 445-2000, false declarations, falsity in public documents and use of false documents are punished according to the penal code and to the current special laws on the subject, declares under my responsibility to accept to perform my final exam via online procedure, that I will not take advantage of any external help during the performance of exam. Siena, 9 June 2021, Marta.
Okay, so the topic of the thesis is to analyze the fashion business, both the evolution of a green and sustainable strategy, and even the approach of digital strategies as in the consumption, so e-commerce, and in production regarding the introduction of a new example of 4.0. The type of methodology of Marta is mixed in the sense that she ran regarding the analysis of the demand 500 interviews to a sample of a consumer in Italy, and she has analyzed two case studies in the sportswear industry. So Marta, please introduce briefly the theoretical background of your thesis and then focus more your attention on the empirical evidence.
Yes.
For you, please try to remain in 15 minutes, 12 minutes presentation and 3-4 minutes of discussion.
Yes. So this is my thesis project, and its aims is to address the issue of sustainability from business point of view, giving particular attention to the fashion industry and to the sportswear sector. The paper is divided into 4 chapters. The first one defines the concept of sustainability and the new consumption behaviors that derive from it, leading consumers to increase the demand of sustainable products thanks to the change in the way they communicate using internet and mobile devices, making digitalization one of the main factors also in light of the COVID-19. The second regards the fashion sustainability, so the sustainability and digitalization in the fashion sector, analyzing proposals and new business strategies based on the idea that consumer behavior is as crucial as the use of technology to create a sustainable type of fashion, analyzing also the effects of the COVID-19. Then we made a demand analysis conducted over 500 consumers, and the last chapter deals with two sportswear case studies to analyze their history, framing them commercially and productively, and then studying their approach to digitalization and sustainability also in reference to their competitors. The objective of the thesis is to give a definition of sustainability, trying to identify the elements that characterize it, what consumption behaviors derive from it, and what consequences they have imposed to companies, which is the role of digitalization, and what is the impact of coronavirus on the behavior and purchasing methods of the population. For what concern then we analyze all these answers about the sportswear industry. For what concern the methodology, we started for the two chapters with the literature review, consulting journals and professional articles such as McKinsey & Company, Boston Consulting Groups, Loudmetrics, and similar. Then for the demand analysis, we conducted a survey on 500 consumers. And for the case studies, we also conducted a survey of the two references studies, and then we analyzed into practice how sportswear companies implement sustainability and digitalization strategies. For what concerns the challenge of sustainability, it is essential to consider that sustainable development satisfies the needs of the present without compromising the possibility of future generations to do the same, increasing the quality of life and the social progress. For this reason, to live in a world that is considered truly sustainable, companies must be compliant with the triple bottom line concept, according to which companies must integrate and harmonize all the three dimensions of sustainability. Economic, which refers to the company ability generate profits with revenues exceeding cost. Environmental, which refers to the fact that the companies know how to make decisions with the low environmental impacts, so reducing the negative ones. And social, which refers to the company's ability to make to identify and managing business decisions, positive and negatives, on people. But sustainability also depends on consumers. In fact, they influence production choices with new behaviors that favor services and products with low environmental impact. Digitalization is also fundamental because it offers innovative and more direct ways of communication through internet and mobile devices, which allow consumers to quickly access information and make more informed and specific decisions and purchases. But it allows also to companies in future to reduce costs and attract more consumers, especially the young one who do most of their business online. Even the impact of the COVID-19 has accentuated this process, changing the behavior and the preferences of consumers, and impacting very strongly on all industrial levels, especially in the period immediately after the outbreak of the pandemic, as can be seen in this graph. For what concerns the fashion sector, it is one of the major economic forces, but also one of the most polluting, mainly because of the fast fashion phenomenon. So for companies was born the idea of the circular economy with the aim of eliminating waste, limiting the use of energy and work, and producing durable products whose materials can be disassembled to renew them, reuse them, and transform them. Consumers with their behaviors can also play their part in this process, given that especially for Generation Z and millennials, it is a priority to help the environment, preferring to buy from companies that are recognized as eco-friendly and considering the quality one of the prerequisites for purchasing. Also, the digitalization plays an important role because it would allow companies a greater production, leading to savings and higher profits, while for customers, it would allow to obtain more information at any time, place, and format they need, creating new expectations. In addition, due to the COVID-19 epidemic, people had to reevaluate their type of clothing and their interests, leading to a significant increase in the purchase of sportswear clothing respect to the other apparel, as can be seen in this chart. To empirically test this concept, we analyzed the result of a demand analysis conducted over 3 months after collecting 500 responses, mostly from Italians, 68% of whom women. The questionnaire is divided into 3 sections. The first one refers to general purchases behavior. The second regards the effects of COVID-19. And the last one concerns the consumer's approach to sustainable fashion. For what concerns the consumer's attitude, the first thing to notice is that consumers tend to spend less money independently from the frequency of purchases. And this means that they forget the fact that when they buy a product, its price is given from all its production stages and not only from something. This means that something has been left out, generally the work cost. In general, young people try to change their behavior, seeking to buy better quality clothing so that they have to make subsequent purchases only to substitute the old products. This can be a sustainable attitude, but this is not sufficient, especially because at the time of actual purchase, consumers don't take much into account elements such as materials and the place of production of the clothes. For what concerns purchases distribution, physical stores have not completely been replaced by the online channels, even if consumers are getting used to adopt this type of method to make their purchases. Also, thanks to the spread of the COVID-19 and its consequent lockdown and closing impositions. For what concerns sustainable attitude, the majority of consumers adopt a confused behavior because many of them prefer to give a new life to their garments, donating them or giving them away. But still many tend to throw them or store them in the closet, meaning that the sustainable behavior is not yet widespread because these consumerist actions are very polluting. For our interviewees, moreover, at the time of purchase, sustainable behavior is projected onto the product packaging, which is required to be recyclable. But these show a little movement towards sustainability, but they ignore elements that they have considered as important as materials and composition of the garments. What is more, people who are informed and commit to sustainability find difficult to find the information about sustainable retailer, and they are not prepared to pay a surcharge for these products, and for this reason they don't translate their beliefs into real behaviors. The last chapter empirically verifies the approach to sustainability and digitalization of two sportswear companies. We have the company Alpha, which is which produces high quality ski sport clothing. It is based on the motto make it personal, meaning that this is the first Italian brand in the field of sportswear to propose a tailor-made project. It is a relatively small company, which is based on a seasonal market demand, and it has a marketed production process, meaning that the company defines the models, the materials, the separate base for the model, but then it is are the producers who effectively buy the raw materials and make the finished product. The second company is the company Beta. It is initially produced alpine ski equipment, but then in the early 2000s, it passed to a more luxurious production with ski and après-ski clothing. It is a company very large nowadays, operating on a seasonal market demand and with a unique strategy, which is reinforced by its ability to propose and develop innovative products consistently with its heritage, implementing a production cycle that relies also on third parties, but which is still supervised and controlled by the company itself. Then we made an analysis of the competitors in terms of sustainability and of the companies in terms of Industry 4.0. For what concerns the company Alpha, it has as competitors Energia Pura, MGP Sportswear and DKB Sports. All are small, medium-sized companies with revenues between 2 million of euro and 11 million of euro, with the type of market B2B and B2C and an European production. What we can see from this analysis is that from social sustainability and environmental sustainability point of view, smaller companies are not very concrete in terms of real projects and initiatives, but they have the intention in the future to implement this part. This is different from the DKB Sport company, which is a medium-sized one, which adopts practices for both dimension of sustainability. In terms of Industry 4.0, the company is an outsider. This because at the moment it has no interest in implementing this type of management, having as the only digital activity an external collaboration for simulation techniques using 3D printers. For what concerns the company Beta, its competitors are La Sportiva, Oberalpe and Esemplare, all relatively large companies with more than 55 million of turnover, with European production and B2B and B2C markets, all engaged in sustainability initiatives from many years. In fact, all the companies draw up annual sustainability reports, efforts and implement concrete environmental and social strategies, both to reduce, for example, the CO2 emission, the chemical presence, the waste of raw materials, but also to encourage the use of recycled garments, recycled fabrics, recycled materials, renewable energies, and to improve the quality, the safety of workers, both encouraging an environment respectful of human rights, but also subjecting workers to training activities, not only to improve their abilities, but also to improve their safety. For what concerns the Industry 4.0, the company is an experience because it has made numerous investments in Industry 4.0, in this management, especially in the past 3 years, and it has the intention to do more in the future. To conclude, we turned out that sustainability and digitalization go hand in hand at strategic level, especially in fashion companies, because these companies go towards more sustainable practices, also using digital tools, both for consumers to obtain more information, but also for companies themselves to integrate sustainability issues with their objectives. These processes were also accentuated by the COVID-19 epidemic, because in this period, fashion companies came closer to digitalization, given the new consumer awareness, which are translated and leading to improve the interaction between consumers and the brands, because of the new consumers' attitude, awareness, translated into buy less but online at medium prices, especially sportswear, given the new lifestyle imposed by the pandemic and the desire of health and well-being. Thank you for your attention.
Okay, thank you, Antichi, to remain in a short time because you had lots of data and you had to cut the part of the presentation. In terms of theory, there is a novelty in the sense that in general we treat in terms of strategy, digitalization and sustainability separately. But you have evidence in your both in empirical analysis and a little in the theory, that there is a sort of correlation between the two phenomena, no? Both at demand level and offer level. Can you tell me something regarding, you spend an internship period in one of these firms, okay? So you had the opportunity to see in depth why the sportswear industry, let's say, perform much better than other type of fashion business. Because during COVID, you know, the consumer changed the approach towards, you know, how they buy and what they buy. But at the same time, some firms continue to invest in digitalization, both at consumer level and, you have said, Industry 4.0 at production level.
Yes.
So, why sportswear industry perform better, and why large firm are much aware of the challenge of sustainability? Is a problem of resources in terms of money, or is a problem of competence? We must say that you have done an internship in the firm Alpha, so the small firm. Okay.
Yes. For what concern these. This question, what I have discovered during my internship is that a small firm has not only money problems, but also differences in terms of priority, because the small firm has the priority to convey its brand all over the world rather to approach to sustainability, even if this can be not a really good strategy, because sustainability also helps to convey the brand and to spread the brand all over the world. So this is the first result. The fact that a small company is not interested in sustainability, not only because of money problems, but also because it thinks that it is better to go all over the world, but lifting the sustainability part, even if now it is increasingly being important, especially for young consumers, as we said before.
Why sportswear perform better?
sportswear performed better, especially because of the new, especially in this year, because of the new interests of consumers and their priorities. They have understood that health is important, hygiene is important, well-being is important. For this reason, they are more interested in taking care of themselves. They stay home the major part of the year, and they have decided to substitute the formal garments, the formal clothing, with something more comfy and sporty. Yes.
Okay, for me it's enough. Tania or Tommaso?
No, for me it's fine, Lorenzo. I really appreciated the discussion.
Okay. It's okay. Also, the best example is that only me and Tommaso wear a tie in this. Even Cristiano, that in general is quite formal, you know, the tie disappear. So we are changing our approach. We don't know if we are sustainable, but you know. Okay, Marta, thank you very much. Now I introduce Andrea Ferrari. Supervisor is Cristiano Jacopozzi. Marta, please, can you switch off the your slide? If you don't switch off the slide, your slide, okay, thank you. Andrea Ferrari, okay, thank you. Andrea, first of all, you read the declaration, and then Cristiano introduce quickly the candidate. Andrea, I cannot hear you. Maybe have you the microphone?
Your microphone is off.
Can you hear me?
Okay.
Now yes. Before not.
Oh, so I can hear you.
You cannot hear us? Non ci sente Ferrari? Ci sente?
Io ora sì.
Ah, okay. You have to read the declaration and then Professor Jacopozzi introduce your thesis.
Okay.
Even for you, 15 minutes. So 12 minutes of presentation and 3 minutes of discussion.
Okay. The undersigned Andrea Ferrari, matricula number 089071, enrolled in the course di laurea magistrale in finance, considering the decree number 461/2020, protocol number 52533 of Director of the University of Siena, dated March 11th, 2020, which authorizes the online procedure for the final exam, graduation and public proclamation, being aware that according to the article 76 of the DPR 445/2000, false declaration, falsity in public documents, and use of false documents are punished according to the penal code and the current special laws on the subject, declares under his own responsibility to accept to perform his final exam via online procedure, that he will not take advantage of any external help during the performance of the exam. Asciano, June 9th, 2021.
Cristiano, introduci brevemente te il candidato.
Okay, good morning, thank you, Andrea. So, your thesis is about a well-known subject, anomalies and calendar effects in seasonalities in the behavior of financial markets, in particular of stock markets, of equity markets. So we kindly ask you to make a brief analysis of your results, showing what you obtained with regard to the main anomalies, and also with some regard to other types of anomalies you analyzed with regard to other types of financial markets. You have, remember very well, the time at your disposal is around 12 minutes, okay? Thank you, Andrea.
Okay. Thank you. So I will present. Okay, can you see my screen?
Yes.
Okay,
perfect. So I start by talking briefly about the efficiency of the market. So a brief theory review. Then we'll move on talking about the anomalies in literature with some definitions and categorizations. Then with focus on calendar anomalies to understand better my research, in which I have investigated in the thesis more anomalies, but here I will present Halloween, turn of the month within the month, and holidays effect. And finally, the conclusions. So these are the three types of efficient market hypotheses made by FAMA. There are the weak form, semi-strong form, and the strong form. Briefly, the strong form includes all the semi-strong and weak form points. The semi-strong includes all the weak form points. According to the efficient market and random walk theories that have become dominant from 1970s, they are in line at least with the weak form efficient market hypothesis. In fact, many points can be retrieved here. According to these theories, the operators are perfectly rational and their behavior can be represented by the model of maximization of expected utility. In addition, it should not be possible to find elements of regularity in the behavior of financial assets, and financial assets follow paths of pure randomness. Anyway, if elements of statistical regularity are found, the actions of arbitrageurs should lead in a short period of time to eliminate them, making it impossible to benefit in terms of profits. Behavioral finance theories rose in the 90s, criticized the model of maximization of expected utility of the previous theories because it fails to correctly portray the real behavior of economic operators, since they are not perfectly rational, but they made suboptimal decisions due to several disturbing factors such as limited time or to complex problems. The 2002 is an important year for behavioral finance theories, with the Nobel Prize assigned to Daniel Kahneman. It is the year of the definitive affirmation of this discipline and the acceptance of anomalies in the financial markets. Anomalies attributable to the absence of perfect rationality of operators in decision making and the inability of market prices to react instantly to the dissemination of new information. So, how is defined an anomaly in literature? As a distortion in return that contradicts the efficient market hypothesis. There are different families of anomalies, market anomalies, related to fundamentals, such as price earnings, dividend yield, and so on. Anomalies linked to past price performance or technical anomalies, such as momentum or trend following ones, and anomalies attributable to seasonality, calendar anomalies, the ones I will present, anomalies linked to specific calendar days or periods, and weather-related anomalies linked to climate. Two more things about anomalies. Not all the anomalies are real-world profitable anomalies, since many scholars presented anomalies, but just in gross returns. Then after training costs have been deducted, anomalies disappeared. And the permanence of anomalies over time is a challenge to the efficient market theories because it states that once the existence of an anomaly has been ascertained and confirmed in the academic literature, it should vanish soon. These are the anomalies I have investigated. Halloween effect, known better as sell in May and go away, is a market timing strategy based on the hypothesis that stocks perform better between November 1st, which is Halloween, and the 13th of April, than from the period from May to October. Turn of the month effect, these two scholars noted that S&P 500 performance in the 4 days around the end of the month was around 7 times bigger than the average return over a period of 4 trading days of S&P. Within the month anomalies, because an anomaly, an instrument can be studied also in a specific period of the month. So maybe a period of the month can be a particularly high or low return. Finally, holidays effect. Holidays are interesting periods to be studied also by psychologists because holidays are generally associated to a positive increase on human mood, and a positive increase in human mood generally cause a greater propension to risk. So investor, according to this theory, should prefer stocks, risky assets, than bonds. I have found contradictions in literature about anomalies in stock market, for example, because some scholars state that anomalies are still present and profitable, but others conclude that anomalies, many anomalies are over and their golden age was the 19th century. These are the years in which I have found the first publication in academic literature. For anomaly effect is 2002, 92 for turn of the month effect, 87 within the month, and 90 holidays effect. I remember that the permanence of anomalies over these years will be a challenge to the efficient market theory. So this is my research. Firstly, I investigated the Halloween effect, selling May and go away, by building a four seasonal portfolio and comparing with two benchmarks. The two benchmarks are the buy and hold of S&P 500, portfolio number one, and portfolio number two, a portfolio composed by 50% of S&P 500 and the other part of 10-year treasury bond, US government bond. I built four seasonal portfolio by analyzing the Dow Jones Industrial Average Return and 10-year T-note yield over the last century by looking at each month performance during the quantitative phases. Briefly, quantitative phases outside the scope of this thesis are the four stages of a long-term economic cycle discovered by Kondratiev. And each phase is identifiable because it differs, among others, with indicators such as GDP growth, PMI, inflation growth rate, and so on. So these are the results. Just one thing. I noticed that the best months, with just two exceptions for S&P 500, are the ones comprised to the in the Halloween period, so from November to April, with just exceptions of July and February. So these are the results in gray and black line, the benchmarks. In particular, the black line is the S&P 500. So these backtests are made with daily data from 1928 to 2021. These are net returns, so I deducted trading costs, and I noticed that seasonal strategies have beaten the benchmarks on most metrics, first on total profit, and in particular S&P 500 on reward risk ratio, which I built by dividing the average yearly return with the standard deviation of the yearly returns. In particular, the best two strategies, the ones in green and blue line, have Sharpe and Sortino ratios about 50% greater than both the benchmarks. The other effect, the turn of the month effect, I studied this effect by building two different strategies. I called them LPM and L4PM, LPM meaning last previous month, so it buys S&P 500 in the last trading days of the closing month. The second one, L4PM, buys the S&P 500 in the fourth to last trading day of the month, and both strategies close the position at the closing price of the third trading day of the new month. I noticed that both strategies did well in terms of reward risk ratio. Both have been profitable in net terms, but the best one is the one in red line, the L4PM, which can be defined as a trivial as well an effective filter to profit from S&P 500, because it has a reward risk 50% greater than S&P 500, which is here 0.62 versus 0.4. And the total profit very close to it, even if it stays in the market just 7 trading days over 23 in a month, its equity line is more stable without a huge bull run, neither big drawdowns. I studied the average trade, gross return of a trade of both strategies. I noticed that an average trade of LPM is more than 4 times greater than an average return of the buy and hold in 4 days. And an average trade of L4PM is more than 3 times greater than a buy and hold in 7 days. The other anomaly effect is the within the Mont effect, here I studied the performance of S&P 500 and Treasury note future, these in different periods, this is in sample, out of sample, and entire. Let's just focus with the entire period. I noticed two very interesting things. First, on S&P 500, the average return on the first part of the month is such greater than the average return in the second part. But even more interesting, the return in the first quarter of the month is triple than the mean return of a quarter. Instead, on the Treasury note future, the return in the second part of the month is the double of the return of the first part. But just by looking on the last 10 years, the TLT ETF, which invests in the long-term U.S. Treasury bonds, the return in the second part of the month has been 0.72% versus almost zero return on the first part of the month. I built three portfolios, but none of them have been able to beat the benchmark, the S&P 500. So I move on with the holidays effect. Here I get interesting results. So briefly, I built to study the impact of the holiday effect in the S&P 500 by building three types of strategies, type A, B, and C. The type A operates after the holiday, the type B operates before the holiday, and the type C operates across the holidays. For example, the C33 buys the S&P three trading days before the holiday and sell three trading days after the holiday. The whole B31 before buys 3 days before the holiday and sell one trading day before the holiday, so at the eve of the holiday. So I noticed that the best strategies are the ones that enters in the market before the holiday, so type B and C, and the very best one is the one in blue line, which is the whole C33, which has a reward risk ratio similar to buy and hold, but its stability is greater. Its net equity line is constantly growing since 1928, with very few periods far by its all-time high. I studied the 11th holidays composing the whole C33 portfolio, and I noticed that each holiday have had a positive gross return, while just three of them a negative net return. The very best one are the days around the new year, with a return more than 8 times greater than an average return of S&P in 6 days, 0.16% versus 1.40%, then following Independence Day, Christmas Day, and Good Friday. Then I ask myself, what is the most influenced day by an holiday? And the answer is gave by this table, in which I have found that the most influenced day by an holiday is the day immediately preceding it. In fact, an average return of the strategy that buys at the eve, the morning, and close at the closing price, so in the evening of the trading day before the holiday, has the greatest difference of returns, 0.15% minus 0.03%, which is the average return of the buy and hold in a period of 1 day. Then the daily difference is the difference divided by the number of days. The day is the most influenced by an holiday, and the holiday effect, as it is logical, is progressively decreasing as we move further to the holiday, from the holiday. So finally, the conclusions. These are the anomalies I have investigated, Halloween effect, turn of the month, within the month, and I noticed that almost all of them have had positive results even after the year of publication in academic literature. In literature, two are the main explanation about the causes of such anomalies. The first one is the change in human mood, and then in the propension to risk due to an event such as a holiday. And the second one is the irregularity of capital inflows and outflows in a market, for example, due to the timing of monthly cash flows received by a pension fund, which are invested in a stock market, maybe in a specific period of the month of the year. I have found the contradictions in literature about the existence of anomalies, and I think this can be one of the causes of their persistence. So having seen these results statistically significant, I confirm the existence of anomalies in the market, and that markets are not always efficient, since it has been possible to profit from them even after 10 or 20 years from their publication in academic literature. I conclude by saying that a trader want to benefit from an anomaly such as this should understand the underlying causes and monitor them to adapt to any changes. And then, in my opinion, it would be better to integrate calendar anomalies to other kinds of elements, for example, with the expansion or recession phases of economy and the phases of the long-term quantitative cycle. Thanks for the attention. No, non sento.
Presidente, l'audio.
Thank you. Question from the supervisor or Andrea Menchiari.
A brief question, Andrea. What do you think, briefly, your conclusion, do you think is it possible to manage an institutional portfolio simply using calendar anomalies or the role of seasonalities? Or do you think this is only a tool to improve an institutional, the management of an institutional portfolio?
Yeah, I think more the second thing. So it can be a tool to improve the trading of an institution. And I hear that it is like this. They are not used, the calendar anomaly is not used alone, but as an additional filter to add to fundamental analysis and other analysis to improve maybe the timing of a trading strategy. Even if I think that maybe with a little part of the capital, maybe a bank decide to dedicate a little capital to algorithmic trading, I think it can be used because a bank can afford this more risk.
Andrea Menchiari, sì. Domande?
No.
For me, no question.
Okay, by my point of view, and I have a curiosity because you know behavioral economics depends on culture. So you have run an analysis regarding Standard & Poor's, but the you know, the holidays and you know, the calendar has not the same you know importance all over the world. Did you find some international comparative analysis? For example, I can imagine in August in Italy we have the ghost town, you know, with a larger effect. But for example, we don't have Halloween, so. Because the financial market are global financial market, you know, you have to consider different, you know, behavior and different type of calendar. Did you find some publication regarding it?
Okay, see, yes, I found that, for example, Halloween effect is not only a phenomena of US. Is maybe a global phenomena. I don't know global, but advanced economy has an Halloween effect. And it is one of the most present one. Regarding holiday, I read the paper that states that also U.S. In U.S. market, holidays effect have been disappeared. And in this paper were written that also in other countries, holidays effect is not present. But it is... a future research I will do to collect other countries' holidays, because each country has its holidays, and then research whether for a specific country there is an holiday effect with its holidays, not the US holidays.
Okay, thank you, Andrea. E su Halloween bisognerebbe chiedere a Pucci, se ha, che ha due figli piccoli, se gli compra la zucca.
Sì, anche... tutti gli anni.
Ecco, vedi, perché siamo cambiati noi italiani, quindi Halloween è diventata una cosa mondiale. Bene, thank you, Andrea. Can you switch off your video?
Yeah.
And now we have Nino Tortorici discussing a thesis with Professor Casprini. The title of the thesis is Innovating Iconic Products, the Fiat 500 Case. Please read us the declaration, and then Elena introduce the candidate.
Okay. The undersigned Nino Tortorici, matricola number 089538, enrolled in the Corso di Laurea Magistrale in International Accounting and Management, considering the decree number 461/2020, protocol number 52533 of the rector of the University of Siena, dated March 11th, 2020, which authorizes the online procedure for the final exam, graduation, and public proclamation. Being aware that according to Article 76 of the DPR 445/2000, false declaration, falsity in public documents, and use of false documents are punished according to the Penal Code and to the current special laws on the subject, declares under his own responsibility to accept perform his final exam via online procedure, that he will not take advantage of any external help during the performance of the exam. Ribera, June 9th, 2021.
Okay, so while maybe Andrea Ferrari, you have still your presentation, the screen shared. So in case you can, okay, thank you. So while Nino will upload his thesis, his presentation, just a few words. The idea of this thesis has born several months, more than 1 year ago, actually. And it is related to one passion that Nino has had about iconic products. And the thesis is an experimental thesis in which Nino has analyzed in depth how innovation happens in iconic products, so defining what the iconic products. And in particular, he had investigated the case of Fiat 500, doing both an interview and a lot of archival data analysis on Fiat 500, plus a survey on consumers for understanding their perceptions about what you will see soon. So I leave the floor to Nino.
Okay, can you see the presentation?
Yes, we can.
Okay, so thanks and good morning to everyone. So the issue of innovation of iconic products is of fundamental importance for all those companies that can boast of having a product in their catalogs and that can be defined as such. The brand involved must balance the heritage of tradition with innovation to develop the evolution of iconic products. The purpose of this thesis is to understand how it is possible to innovate an iconic product, which is the innovation path of an iconic product, and how is an iconic product perceived by the consumers. To answer these questions, I have used three types of research methodologies. So I have done a literature review on the basic arguments, which are innovation, design, iconic products. Then through study of historical archives and then an interview with Roberto Giolito, I focused on the case of Fiat 500. And finally, the last methodology I used was a questionnaire to analyze the consumer perception about the Fiat 500 as an iconic product. So, innovation is the applicative dimension of an inventory or a discovery. It is the realization of a new or significantly improved product or service. Innovation activities require the combination of creativity, resources, and skills. The collaboration between innovators are very important because they can leverage knowledge and resources. According to their nature, intensity, effect on skills, and destination, we can distinguish different types of innovation. Moving to design, the word design literally means planning and is the logical solution to a problem and the satisfaction of a need. It describes how an object is made, how it looks aesthetically, and what its function, how it should be used. The designers is an inventor, is the controller of the identity of the innovation and the cultural and communicational director of the company's product. But what would be the sense of investing resources and energy to create new form and solution if once they come to light, it can be copied and used by other companies? This question highlights the fundamental importance of intellectual property protection. Intellectual property refers to a system of legal protection of intangible assets. Protection of design and the model refers to aesthetic aspect of the product, so the drawing and the shape. Now we move to the central topic, the iconic products and their innovation. The word icon means something about a representative symbol worthy of veneration. So icons are linked to culture, to peoples, and what the meaning of that particular forms is for them. Today, the word iconic is much used, but often misused, defining iconic any successful object. But the characteristic of that an iconic product must have are simplicity of use and ease of recognition, immediately distinguishable memorability, it must be able to set a new standard for the market, it must not get tired or look older after a few years, it must be creating a gap with all existing products. It is important to underline some sort of correlation between iconic products and the marketing campaign. A company that creates a winning marketing campaign can make an exceptional product memorable. Fundamental to this concept is also the role of diffusion of the object. To understand how important the concept of iconicity is connected to a product, it is interesting to analyze the case of emoji. If we look at these two emoji taken from a smartphone keyboard, we can immediately recognize the two objects, a guitar and a scooter. But if we go deeper, we can see that the guitar is represented by the design of a Fender Stratocaster, and the scooter is represented by the design of Piaggio Vespa. These are two iconic products. In this thesis, I analyzed many iconic products from different sectors to compare them and understand if they have undergone an innovative path. What was emerging from this study is that iconic products can be classified in four macro categories according to their innovative path. The first category is evergreen and includes those products that are still used today and that have undergone small changes and innovation during the years. The examples could be the Coca-Cola bottle or the sunglasses Ray-Ban Aviator. The category iconic vintage includes products born with the purpose to be spread as much as possible, designed for customers with low budget, but are now considered vintage objects and have a very high market value. An example could be the Superleggera chair designed by Joe Ponti. The category passed icon include products that have revolutionized the market, dictating the pace to follow for decades, but which are now longer in use due to the technical evolution. An example for this category is the Walkman produced by Sony. The last category, innovative icon, in the last category are placed products that over the years have undergone a strong innovation. So the technology progress has changed this object and adapt them to the times. The most interesting examples to analyze belonging to automotive world, like Fiat 500, Mini, and Volkswagen Beetle. So let's move to the Fiat 500 case. This part has been elaborated thanks to the previous interview with given by Roberto Giolito. Giolito has been the project leader for the creation of the new Fiat 500 that came out in 2007. The innovative part of Fiat 500, in this innovative path, the years to highlight are 1957, 2007, and 2020. In those years, were launched on the market three versions with the same name, with strong references to shape and aesthetically, but totally different from each other, positioned in three different price ranges and seeking to hit as many target customers. In 1957, the main attempts that made the Fiat 500 as an iconic product were mass production, optimization of product production process, standard technologies, and low maintenance of cost for the vehicle. In 2007, 50 years later, Fiat decided to differentiate the product 500 from other models by placing it in a premium segment A category. Customers were also offered a wide range of customization and a high quality production. The last version presented in 2020 is the new electrical 500. The innovative car arrives in a totally renewed way in terms of both design and construction technology used. The electric 500 is aimed at the pioneers of the new way of understanding mobility who are willing to pay more to position themselves among the first users of electric cars. At this point, it is fundamentally important to understand the dynamic of how a company like Fiat, after many years since the release of the original models, can guarantee commercial success and the role of an iconic product in the consumer imagination, in this case, the 500. According to Giolito, the answer to this question is the continuous and constant innovation. And Fiat has been a brand that has been able to sustain a high degree of innovation in creating archetypes and permanent patterns. So, in this last part, I focused on the analysis of the questionnaire entitled The Fiat 500 Icon, carried out in March 2021, and aimed at understanding how the iconic product Fiat 500 is perceived, how the public approach to it, and how which are the main factors that consumer attributes when thinking to 500. Analyzing the personal answers of the respondent, what comes out is the profile of a young average interviewee, mainly from the center of south of Italy, with a personal annual income that is on average around 10,000 euros. Analyzing only car owners, about 13% own a Fiat 500. For simplicity of analysis, the Fiat 500 product was divided into four macro categories that represent the Fiat 500 produced up to the 70s, the 500 produced up to the 90s, the 500 produced since 2007, and the 500 produced since 2020, so the electric version. The version perceived as most iconic by respondents is one produced up to the 70s, with over half of those interviewed expressing the highest appreciation for this model, followed by the 2007 models, then the electric version, and finally the version of the 90s. Sorry. To better understand dynamics of public perception, the questionnaire includes four questions with the Likert scale to classify in order of importance the factors that each person attributes when thinking to Fiat 500 as an icon product. The factors are craftsmanship, made in Italy, essentiality of shapes, design, recognizability, exclusivity, elegance, and innovativeness. For the 70s version, the first factor that the interview gives most important is the made in Italy, as we can see in the first graph. The 500 produced in the 90s is not perceived as an iconic product, and in fact, the score recorded by different slowdown compared to the others' figures. For the model building starting from the 2007, the perception of iconic products increased, and the recognizability of the size indicated as the first factor. For the electric version, energy that is highly appreciated by the public, about as much as the previous 2007. Also, this model design recognizability is the first and most important factor that we sample and samples things about. As conclusion to the question, respondents were asking questions about their purchasing preference. So, regarding which one they would choose, 20% would refer to a vintage produced up to 70s. The 33% would refer by the 2007 version. But the answers went to the electric version. There is a no universal recipe for iconic products in question. But it is a process approached differently based on the type of product, external factors, and management approach. Designer, engineers, and marketers must work together to succeed in being market innovative economic products. The limitation of this research is that only the 500 case study examined, and examples given introduce the distinction between costs and limited. Future research would involve as many conics products as possible to understand if distinction made on the four types of products is valid, or if it should go undergo. Moreover, it will be interesting to compare more case studies and therefore more related to iconic products. So, thanks for your attention and for your time.
Oh, thank you very much, Nino, for your presentation. Are there maybe questions from the rest? Otherwise, I will proceed with one question.
Okay. I'm sorry because the quality of the voice at the end was not so good. But regarding the approach towards the iconic product, I have two questions. One is it possible that the marketing budget can influence the results of a Likert scale? For example, I remember that a very well known testimonial, DiCaprio was used to convey the message of sustainability for Fiat 500. And the second is regarding the meaning of some of the items that you consider in your legal scale. For example, I noticed that Made in Italy is quite high, even in contemporary period, where we know that the...
Professore, non la sente, ha perso la connessione, Nino.
I lost my...
mi sente ora, Tortorici? Mi sente?
Sì, prof, ma avete visto tutta la presentazione?
Perché... la linea sì, va e viene. Sento. Io la presentazione l'ho vista, la qualità del suono non era buonissima.
Adesso non più.
Quindi non si preoccupi, la sua presentazione l'abbiamo vista. Ora, la cosa importante è se lei ci sente per fare un paio di domande. Io non la sento. Mi sente? Mi può dare conferma che mi sente?
Vi sento malissimo, posso uscire e rientrare.
Aspetta, proviamo a spengere magari il video.
Ecco, proviamo a spengere i video.
Tanto siamo...
Chiedo a tutti...
Tecnicamente non si può...
Forse il relatore e il presidente no, gli altri me lo spengano.
Aspetti che Harry sta rientrando.
Perché non appartenente all'Università di Siena?
Okay. No, lo fa tutti. Okay. Ci sente meglio adesso?
Lo fa a tutti, professore, questa storia del non appartenente. Anche sì. All'esame succede così.
Mi sente, Tortorici, ora?
Sì. Mi sente?
Mi sente?
Sì, sì, adesso sì. Ma avete visto la presentazione?
Sì, o... sì, sì.
Sì, l'abbiamo vista, non si preoccupi.
Sì, sì, io la sento.
È la qualità del suono che ora non è buona.
Okay.
Probabilmente perché lei dove sta? In Campania? Dov'è che...
Sicilia.
Ok, vediamo un po' se... two questions. One is the impact of a marketing campaign, so budget, regarding the communication of some of the iconic variable of your product. For example, I know that DiCaprio was a very well-known testimonial to strengthen the sustainable, sustainable approach of the product. And the second is the made-in effect. I noticed that Made in Italy is still very important in the imagination of the consumer. But now we know that some of this product is not produced anymore in Italy, some of the Fiat product. So I don't remember now if all Fiat 500 is produced in Italy. I don't remember if, but for example, I remember that Panda is not anymore an Italian product. So can you tell us something regarding the role of marketing and the role of Made In Effect?
Yes, so the role of marketing is really, really important. Fiat has take a lot of attention in the launch of the version of 2007 and the launch of the last version of 2020, the electric version. In the 2007, the press conference, the day launch was very curated and a lot of went to do this presentation. For the electric version in 2020 has been launched in a particular year, the year of the pandemic. It is launched on the online and not at the normal Geneva motor show, and this type of particular marketing campaign is was very useful to transmit the Fiat 500 aim and the Italianity. So as you can say, the Fiat 500 is not in part produced in Italy, but the product is able to transmit the sensation and the Italianity of the product. So this is the reason.
Okay, for me it's enough. Other question? If there are no other thank you, Tortorici. Now I introduce the last candidate, that is Babayev Ali. The supervisor is Professoressa Tania Groppi, and hello. The second supervisor is Valentina Carlino. Good morning, Babayev.
Good morning.
I look if Valentina Carlino is with us.
She's coming, Lorenzo.
Okay, can we begin?
She's coming because I sent her a message, okay. But probably we can start.
Okay, Babayev, you have to read the declaration and then Tania introduce the candidate. Even for you, Babayev, you have 12 minutes. Okay, thank you, Valentina, to join us.
Okay. The undersigned Ali Babayev, matricula number 078933, enrolled in the Corso di Laura Magistrale in Accounting and Management, considering the degree number 461, 2020, protocol number 52533 of the record of University of Siena, dated March 11 to 2020, which authorized the online procedure for the final exam, graduation, and public proclamation, being aware that according to Article 76 of the DPR 445/2000, false declarations, falsity in public documents and use of false documents are punished according to the penal code and to the current special laws on the subjects. Declares under my own responsibility to accept to perform my final exam by online procedure, that I will not take advantage of any external help during the performance of the exam. Place Baku, Azerbaijan, and date on 9 May 2021.
Thank you. Tania?
Okay. The student Ali Babayev is presenting a thesis on the economic development in Azerbaijan in accounting and management. Then I'm going to ask to present shortly the content of this work. Please, Ali, the floor is yours.
Okay. Just one moment. I cannot, it's not working. Share. Working.
If the slide doesn't work, you introduce the thesis without it.
Okay. Now, sorry about this. My thesis consists of three chapters. There are three questions in each of each chapter. Chapter first deals with the history of Azerbaijan, its origin and development path. Chapter two deals with the independence of the Republic of Azerbaijan and its withdrawal from the USSR. This chapter focuses on the economic difficulties of the first years of independence and finding ways out of them. Chapter 3 deals with the state programs and their implementation, legal and regulatory framework. The first question is source of the history of Azerbaijan, origin, territory and natural geographical conditions. Just a moment. It's rare for a country to be able to preserve the name it has been given since ancient times. The name of the of the states existing in the territories of Azerbaijan were formed on the basis of various factors. Sorry, I confused. Just a moment. A little bit nervous.
Don't worry.
Okay.
Take your time.
Among these factors, such as the name of the ethnos or persons, the geographical features of the area played a great role. For example, in the territory of Azerbaijan south and east south of Lake Urmia, in the first of half of the century, millennium before century, the state of Arata existed. The name of the country Arata simply meant mountainous country, and apparently the name of the country was associated with the geographical feature of the territory. Nowadays, there are two main views on the origin of the name Azerbaijan. Some authors connect the origin of the name of Azerbaijan with the name of the commander of Atropat with a personal factor. Others try to establish the connection of the name of Azerbaijan with the geographical factors. According to another approach, the etymology of the name Azerbaijan connected with the word of ADYR, which is in Turkish toponymy means hate, hill, hilly foothills, mountain range. It is known that a large part of South Azerbaijan part of Azerbaijan is are mountains. So the second question is Azerbaijan Democratic Republic as the basis of the independent Azerbaijan state. After Georgia and Azerbaijan left the Transaction Caucasus Federation on May 26, 1918, they declared its independence. After that, just a moment, I confused.
Excuse me, Ali, probably you can just talk about the recent development of the Azerbaijan state, not all the history of the country, because you don't have enough time.
Okay, Professor. Okay, the role of the Azerbaijan state in the USSR and its economic development. On July 14, 1969, an important event took place in the political life of Azerbaijan. So, at the plenum of the Central Committee of the Communist Party of Azerbaijan, Heydar Aliyev was elected first secretary of the Central Committee. The year 1969 laid the foundation for a turning point in modern history of Azerbaijan. In his speech in the August plenum, Heydar Aliyev made an in-depth and comprehensive analysis about country's economy, noted serious shortcomings and in economic management, cultural construction and ideological work. So as a result, in the 1970s, all major economic indicators in Azerbaijan steadily increased. In 14 years, the total volume of the national income in the Republic increased 2.5 times, industrial production 2 times, consumer goods 3 times, gross agricultural output 2.7 times, more than 250 factories, plants, production workshops were built, and housing conditions improved, and so on. About 72% of the new industrial enterprises established in 1997 and 1980 were put into operation in other areas of republics. The volume of gross agricultural output in the Republic in 1981-85 increased by an average of 2.6 times compared to 1966. In 1981-85, grain production reached 1.3 million tons, cotton 864,400 tons, wool 56 and 1,000 tons, grape 1.9 million tons.
Tania or Valentina, can you do a question to Ali to conclude the discussion?
Valentina, would you like to ask something?
Yes. Ali, please, could you tell us something about the recent intervention of the Azerbaijan state in the development of the national economic, the last part of your thesis? Just a few words.
Okay.
The last chapter.
Okay. Just a moment.
Just to sum up.
Okay. Just a moment, confused.
Yes, don't worry, just something that you wrote on your conclusions.
Ali, don't worry.
I'm a little bit nervous, sorry about it.
Don't worry. Okay, it's enough for
okay,
me.
Okay, yes.
It's enough.
Yes, okay, good. We can conclude here for me as well.
Okay.
Yeah, thank you.
I ask all the candidates to wait 10 minutes in the public. We switch off and we go in a private room and we go back in 10 minutes. So at midday, at 12, with the results. Okay. Thank you.
Okay.
Thank you.
Okay. Good morning again to everybody. I just now call each candidate with the name. I ask them to read the second declaration after the results. Now, Bohama Veri Azumadu, Miss Azumadu, given the results of your academic career and the presentation of your thesis, this commission has approved your degree examination with a score of 90 out of 110. The four by the powers conferred us by the rector of this university, we proclaim you in the name of the law, dottore magistrale in management and governance. Congratulations, Vera. Please, can you read us the declaration?
I switch on the camera because at least me, I'm not able to see you.
Vera, switch on your camera, please.
Yeah.
It's not working, the camera?
Yeah, I am doing that. Just a second. Just a second.
Yes.
No, it's not.
Can you maybe try to
join again?
Try to go out and to enter.
Yes.
Can you see me?
No, not yet, Vera.
Okay.
Sorry for all the other, but for the declaration, we need to see the face. Se no vado avanti. Oh, vediamo un po'.
Ecco, no, aspettiamo 2 secondi.
Ah, okay, now we see you, Vera. Thank you. Can you read the declaration, please? No, we see you, but we cannot hear you.
Can you hear me now?
Okay, now yes. Please read the declaration.
All right. Okay, so Vera Asuma Dubwama, matricula 070-396, enrolled in the Corso di Laurea Magistrale in International Management and Accounting, considering the decree number 461-2020, protocol number 52533 of the which authorizes the online procedure for the final exam graduation and public proclamation. Being aware that according to the Article 76 of the DPR 44, falsity in public documents and use of false documents are punished according to the Penal Code and to the current special laws on the subject. I declare that I have participated in the graduation exam on 9th of June 2021 during the final exam section of the academic year 2019-2020 for the achievement of the final qualification. I accept the evaluation of the final mark with which is declared Dottoressa Magistrale in place Bratislava date 9th.
Thank you, Vera.
June 2021.
Thank you, Vera, and congratulations by all the commission. I will talk to all the candidates at the end. Now is the turn of Romina Pagnano.
Thank you.
Romina, la commissione, visti i risultati della carriera accademica svolta e valutata la tesi presentata, ha approvato il suo esame di laurea con votazioni 110 su 110 e all'unanimità le ha conferito la lode. Pertanto, per i poteri conferitici dal magnifico rettore, la proclamo in nome della legge dottore magistrale in management e governance. Congratulazioni, Pagnano.
Grazie.
Lei legga la dichiarazione.
Sì. La sottoscritta, Pagnano Romina, matricola numero 074751, iscritta al corso di laurea magistrale in Management and Governance Curriculum DECA, visto il decreto del Rettore dell'Università degli Studi di Siena, repertorio numero 461-2020, protocollo numero 52533 del giorno 11 marzo 2020, che autorizza la modalità di svolgimento a distanza della prova finale della proclamazione, consapevole delle sanzioni penali richiamate dall'articolo 76 del DPR 28 dicembre 2000, numero 445, in caso di dichiarazioni mendaci, diffamazione o uso di atti falsi, dichiara di aver partecipato alla seduta di laurea del giorno 9 giugno 2021 della sessione straordinaria dell'anno accademico 2019-2020 per il conseguimento del titolo finale e prende atto della valutazione della votazione finale con le quali è stata proclamata dottoressa magistrale in Management and Governance Curriculum DECA, luogo di presenza dello studente e data Cortona 9 giugno 2021.
Congratulazioni ancora. Grazie. A Pagnano.
Grazie.
Da Kunzi Ivan.
Sì.
L'abbiamo risolto, vero? Scusate ragazzi, i problemi di visibilità dei vostri...
Grazie.
No, meno male, almeno il momento della... Allora, da Kunzi, la commissione, visti i risultati della carriera accademica svolta e valutata la tesi presentata, ha approvato il suo esame di laurea con votazione di 107 su 110, pertanto per i poteri conferitici al magnifico rettore, la proclamiamo in nome della legge dottore magistrale in management e governance. Congratulazioni.
Grazie. Leggo la dichiarazione. Io sottoscritto da Kunzi Ivan, matricola numero 087377, iscritto al corso di laurea magistrale Management and Governance, curriculum DECA, visto il decreto del rettore dell'Università degli Studi di Siena, repertorio numero 461 del 2020, protocollo numero 52533 del giorno 11 marzo 2020, che autorizza la modalità di svolgimento a distanza della prova finale e della proclamazione, consapevole delle sanzioni penali richiamate dall'articolo 76 del DPR 28 dicembre del 2000 numero 445 in caso di dichiarazione mendace e diffamazione o uso di atti falsi, dichiara di aver partecipato alla seduta di laurea del giorno 09/06/2021 della sessione straordinaria dell'anno accademico 2019-2020 per il conseguimento del titolo finale e prende atto della valutazione della votazione finale con le quali è stato proclamato dottore magistrale in management e governance curriculum DECA Nocera Superiore 09/06/2021.
Congratulazioni ancora. Grazie. Marta Antichi. Miss Marta Antichi, given the results of your academic career and the presentation of a thesis, this commission has approved your degree examination with a score of 110 out of 110 with Laude. Therefore, by the power conferred us by the rector of this university, we proclaim you in the name of the law, dottore magistrale in international accounting and management. Congratulations, Antichi.
Thank you.
Can you read the declaration, please?
The undersigned Marta Antichi, matricola number 087469, enrolled in the corso di laurea magistrale in international accounting and management, considering the decree number 461-2020, protocol number 52532 of the rector of the University of Siena, dated March 11, 2020, which authorizes the online procedure for the final exam, graduation, and public proclamation, being aware that, according to Article 66, of the DPR 45,000, false declaration, falsity in public documents, and use of false documents are punished according to the penal code and to the current special laws on the subject, declares under my responsibility that I have participated in the graduation exam on 9th June 2021 during the extraordinary exam session of the academic year 2019-2020 for the achievement of the final qualification, that I accept the evaluation and the final mark which with which I am declared dottoressa magistrale in international accounting and management, Siena 9 of June 2021.
Thank you, Antichi. Andrea Ferrari. Okay, Mr. Andrea Ferrari, given the results of your academic career and the presentation of your thesis, this commission has approved your degree examination with a score of 110 out of 110 with laude. Therefore, by the power conferred in us by the rector of this university, we proclaim you in the name of the law, Dottore Magistrale in Finance. Congratulations. Can you read us the declaration, Andrea? Oh, Andrea disappear.
Sorry.
Ferrari non la vedo più.
È uscito dalla riunione o ha un problema di linea anche lui?
Andrea.
Eccolo di nuovo.
Ferrari ci sente? Ecco, ora la vediamo. Can you read that?
Sì, scusate, mi è crashato il browser.
Però ora la vediamo, non si, però, il voto l'ha già preso, basta solo che ci legga la...
Ah, non ho sentito niente.
Ah, non ha sentito il voto?
No.
Devo rileggere l'intera... Ok, no, siccome ci sono anche i suoi parenti, le leggo un'altra volta. Mr. Andrea Ferrari, given the results of your academic career and the presentation of your thesis, this commission has approved your degree examination with a score of 110 out of 110 with laude. Therefore, by the power conferred in us by the rector of this university, we proclaim you in the name of the law, Dottore Magistrale in Finance. Repetita Juvent, ci può leggere la dichiarazione.
Il sottoscritto Andrea Ferrari, matricola numero 089071, iscritto al corso di laurea magistrale in finance, visto il decreto del rettore dell'Università degli Studi di Siena, repertorio numero 461-2020, protocollo numero 52533 del giorno 11 marzo 2020, che autorizza la modalità di svolgimento a distanza della prova finale della proclamazione, consapevoli delle sanzioni penali richiamate dall'articolo 76 del DPR 28 dicembre 2000, numero 445, in caso di dichiarazioni mendaci e di formazione uso di atti falsi, dichiara di aver partecipato alla seduta di laurea del giorno 9 giugno 2021 della sessione straordinaria dell'anno accademico 2019-2020 per il conseguimento del titolo finale e prende atto della valutazione e della votazione finali con le quali è stato proclamato dottore magistrale in finance. Asciano, 9 giugno 2021.
Congratulazioni. Nino Tortorici.
Sì.
Qui in inglese. Mr. Nino Tortorici, given the results of your academic career and the presentation of your thesis, this commission has approved your degree examination with a score of 104 out of 110. Therefore, by the powers conferred in us by the rector of this university, we proclaim you in the name of the law, Dottore Magistrale in International Accounting and Management. Congratulations, Dottor Ricci. Can you read us the declaration?
Sì. The undersigned Nino Tortorici, matricola number 089538, enrolled in the corso di laurea magistrale in International Accounting and Management, considering the decree number 461-2020, protocol number 52533 of the rector of the University of Siena, dated March 11, 2020, which authorizes the online procedure for the final exam, graduation, and public proclamation. Being aware that according to Article 76 of the DPR 445-2000, false declaration, falsity in public documents, and use of false documents are punished according to the penal code and to the current special law on the subject, declares under his own responsibility that he has participated in the graduation exam on the June 9th, 2021 during the extraordinary exam session of the academic year 1920 for the achievement of the final qualification, that he accepted the evaluation of the final mark with which he is declared Dottore Magistrale in International Accounting and Management, Ribera, June 9th, 2021.
Thank you, Tortorici, and congratulations again. Thank First, last, Babayev Ali. Ali, can we see your face? Thank you. Mr. Babayev Ali, given the results of your academic career and the presentation of your thesis, this commission has approved your degree examination with a score of
76 out of 110. Therefore, by the powers conferring us by the rector of this university, we proclaim you in the name of the law, Dottore Magistrale in Management and Governance. Congratulations. Can you read us the declaration?
Okay. Before reading, I would like to tell you, thank you all of professors that you took your time, waste your time for us, for me. Thank you a lot.
Don't worry, we talk later. Now we finish the bureaucracy.
Okay. The undersigned Ali Babayev matriculum number 078933 enrolled in the Corso di Laurea Magistrale in Accounting and Management, considering the degree number 461-20-2020, protocol number 52533 of the rector of the University of Siena, dated March 11, 2012, which authorized the online procedure for the final exam graduation and public proclamation, being aware that according to Article 76 of the DPR 445-2000, false declarations, falsity in public documents and use of the false documents are punished according to the penal code and to the current special laws on the subject. Declares under my own responsibility that I has participated in the graduation exam on 9 May 2021 during the extraordinary June exam session of the academic year 2019-2012 for the achievement of the final qualification, that I accept the evaluation and the final mark with which I am declared Doctor Magistrale in Accounting and Management. Baku, Azerbaijan, date 9 May 2021.
Thank you, Ali.
Thank you.
Now, some very short congratulations by me, but in the name of all the commission. Obviously, you can contact your supervisor to have special thanks or special contact with them. First, I would half in Italian and half in English. So I try to translate. Per prima cosa, io voglio ringraziare i vostri genitori, i vostri parenti, per la fiducia che hanno accordato all'Università di Siena. Sono stati anni di sacrifici, sono stati anni importanti e sappiamo che non siete solo voi ma anche le vostre famiglie. Quindi grazie per la fiducia e per il tempo che i vostri ragazzi hanno dedicato a noi. I would like to thank not only you for the time spent in Siena or online, unfortunately, but I would like to thank the family that supported you and you choose Siena for your master thesis. Remember that there is the alumni network. The alumni network is out of cost, so it's free. There are many managers that can help you in giving advice for your career, giving important contact for placement opportunity. So my suggestion is to join the network alumni if you haven't done. Your supervisor or me can give you the technical indication how to do this. Il secondo è, ragazzi, ricordatevi che voi rimanete studenti dell'Università di Siena anche alla fine del vostro percorso di studi. Il network alumni è una rete molto importante di contatti che vi permette di avere l'opinione di manager, non solo di docenti, che vi possono indirizzare nel vostro percorso di studi. Non ci sono solo nomi eccellenti, ma persone che lavorano nel mondo delle imprese, che possono, delle pubbliche amministrazioni, che possono darvi consigli utili. Il mio consiglio è di prendere contatto con il network, non costa niente, perché vi può dare una mano per opportunità di lavoro e indirizzarvi per il vostro futuro. Third, remember that you remain a student of the University of Siena for internship opportunity after your graduation. For 1 year, you had the opportunity to be in stage, in internship using our placement office. So if you have the opportunity, we can support you even postgraduate. Il terzo è, ricordatevi che per opportunità di stage sono curriculari ma anche post-curriculari, e quindi siccome il mercato del lavoro ora è abbastanza complesso legato al Covid, l'opportunità di fare uno stage è una delle azioni per completare il vostro percorso formativo. Quindi a nome della commissione, ragazzi, in bocca al lupo. A noi dispiace essere stati online, avremmo preferito essere in presenza a festeggiare con le vostre famiglie, però un bocca al lupo da parte di tutti, e non preoccupatevi se il mercato del lavoro ora è complicato. Il Covid passerà e gli investimenti saranno importanti. Don't worry regarding the job market now, it's a bit complicated, but Next Generation Fund will improve it, and we are sure that there will be many opportunities of job for all of you, independently by the grade that you had. So good luck, buona fortuna a tutti. Se qualche membro della commissione vuole aggiungere qualcosa, è benvenuto. A nome di tutti, comunque, in bocca al lupo, ragazzi. Colleghi, se volete aggiungere...
Io mi permetto di dire questo, professore, che non sempre c'è una conclusione del genere, e credo sia utile come conclusione quella è stata fatta ora per i ragazzi. Ho apprezzato molto la conclusione finale con il riassunto dei suggerimenti, a parte i ringraziamenti di Prassi. Ho apprezzato molto la parte sui suggerimenti e l'operatività richiesta per il dopo laurea, quindi credo sia una quasi da istituzionalizzare, mi permetto di dire questo, e un bocca al lupo a tutti i nostri giovani studenti per il loro futuro.
Beh, ovviamente non siamo delle caselline online, abbiamo anche noi dei figli, sappiamo quanto è difficile il momento, però siamo molto ottimisti e vediamo anche tra di voi degli imprenditori. We see some women and men in foreign country. Remember that you could be the ambassador of the University of Siena in your country, and we will be really pleased to continue to have contact with you even after this moment. Ragazzi, good luck e in bocca al lupo a tutti. La sessione è finita.
Grazie.
Congratulazioni.
Grazie. Congratulazioni.
Elena, per il verbale.
Ci sono, ci sentiamo tra poco.
Dai, grazie, anche così fine.
Grazie, thank you.
Salute a tutti.
Arrivederci. Buona serata a voi.